Thank you, choir. That was beautiful, and absolutely affirmed the message in that song that God heal our land, and we know that He can do that. Nothing is impossible for our God. Well, welcome to Westside Baptist Church. We're happy to have you here today. If you're a first-time guest, we're happy to have you. Or if you're watching us online for the first time, we'd love for you to connect with us. Just text the word welcome to 859-986-3444. We would love to connect with you, tell you a little bit more about our church and what God is doing and how He can work in your life as we follow Him on His mission to reach the world for Christ. Our scripture for today comes from the book of Acts, chapter 2. So we're going to read that one for this service. Acts chapter 2, verse 38 and 39, Peter said to them, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is for you, and for your children, and for all who are far off. Everyone whom the Lord our God calls to Himself." Let us pray. Lord Jesus, we do thank You for the beautiful truth of that scripture, Lord, that You've used Peter and a long line of pastors and preachers and those that you've used, Lord, to share your word, to call the world to repentance, Lord, that we were all born into sin and lost and separated from you, Lord. And that we're thankful today that we will see what you've done in Jada's life, Lord, that she's repented and is being obedient in baptism to follow you, Lord. And we also pray, Lord, in that last part of the passage, that we would, in the front of our minds, we would keep in mind, Lord, that this is for everyone, that whom you've called, and Lord, that you're not willing that any should perish, that all should come to repentance, Lord. We may share that message with our neighbors, and Lord, trust that you're working in the people's lives around us to bring glory to your name. We thank you for this day, and we pray you, we worship you in spirit and truth, Lord. And it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen.
Amen. What a joy it is for me and for all the church to be in these baptismal waters again on this Lord's Day. Today, you're seeing the beginnings of the story of faith for Jada's life as she steps into these waters in just a moment and goes before the God and before the church in obedience through the waters of baptism. And so we are so thankful for her faith today and for the work of grace that God has done in her life. And thankful for her obedience to trust God and follow him in the way that Jesus Christ gave us the pattern and to be baptized. And so at this time, Jada, if you will, come into the waters. Jada, before God and these assembled at the church, I ask you, do you believe that Jesus Christ is God's Son sent into the world to save lost man? Jada, have you received by faith Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior? Amen. Then it is with joy and my duty and honor and privilege to baptize you now, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Blessed forevermore. Amen. You got you there.
Amen, amen. Nothing about having a baptism in the morning, ain't it? At least the water was warm. It wasn't cold. So if you will, stand. We have a responsive reading on 339, and it'll be up on the projectors as well. We'll start with that this morning. It says, your word is a lamp for my feet and a light for my path. I have treasured your word in my heart so that I may not sin against you. I will delight in your statutes. Lord, your word is forever. It is firmly fixed in heaven. How can the young man keep his way pure? By keeping your word. Happy are those who keep his decrees and seek him with all their heart. For every one of God's promises is yes in him. I will not forget your word. I put my hope in your word. I rise before dawn and cry out for help. I put my hope in your word. Let my cry reach you, Lord. Give me understanding according to your word. The entirety of your word is truth, and all your righteous judgments endure forever. I will meditate on your precepts and think about your ways. Open my eyes so that I might see wondrous things in you. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourself. And with that, we will start with our hymn this morning, Standing on the Promises. Standing on the promises of Christ my King, through eternal ages let the praises ring. Glory in the highest I will shout and sing. Standing on the promises of God, standing, standing.
my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God, standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior, standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
Amen, amen. If you will then turn over to 550. The scripture for our hymn for that one is 1 Peter 2:21. It says, "For you were called to this, that so that you should follow in his steps." Our next hymn is Footsteps of Jesus.
Sweetly, Lord, have we heard thee calling,
seated.
Good morning. And again, it's so good to be in God's house today, and I pray you receive a special blessing today to be in his house. This morning, I just want to talk to you a little bit about tithes and offerings, which we talk each year and every week. There are several ways you can give your small portion back to the Lord each and every day and each every week. That is through up on the PowerPoint there are several ways we do it. As you know, our deacons are here on Tuesday and Thursday to be with you. And if you want to drop by with your offering, we would be glad to see you and fellowship with you, pray with you, whatever your needs may be. This morning I have a scripture that we'll put up would be from Proverbs 3:9. Honor the Lord with your wealth and with the fruit, first fruits of all your produce. Let us pray. Father, we thank you again for this morning that we can come to your house and worship you. We ask the Lord that we open our hearts and minds to receive your word today. And I pray for Brother Allen as he brings our message. May he bring us the words that we need to hear during these hard times that we live in this day. Lord, we thank you that you watch over us and you protect us. And Lord, we just pray that all things will be taken care of. We know that you're in control. And I ask the Lord to continue to give us guidance and direction each and every day. We thank you for your precious Son, Jesus Christ, and amen.
Oh, I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, and I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and they tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. Oh, and I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need before we say a word. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. To us. Oh, it's a love so undeniable. I can hardly speak. Peace so unexplainable. I can hardly think as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still as you call me. Deeper still into love. Love, love, love. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways. You are perfect in all of your ways to us. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
It's who I am. It's who I am. You're a good, good father.
You are perfect in all of your ways.
It's who you are. It's who you are, and I'm loved by you.
It's who I am.
It's who I am.
It's who I am.
Amen. What a blessing. Our children can be dismissed at this time for Children's Church, but I'm going to ask Miss Jada. Is Miss Jada in? Oh, yes. Come up here, Miss Jada, and Your church family wants to present you with this. If you'll come up here on stage with me. Jada, again, as I said, thank you for being obedient to the Lord. We praise the Lord for your salvation. I want you to know that you are beautiful and loved by God and by us as well. And we're proud of you, and we want to present you with this copy of God's Word. Keep it close to your heart. Keep getting the Word of God into your soul, and it will transform your life. It's God's Word to you. He's never silent as long as that Bible's open, okay? I love you. Amen. Thank you. Thank you. Well, let me join others in welcoming you this morning. What a blessing it already has been to be in the Lord's house, as it was in our first service and in Sunday school as well. You can turn with me in just a moment. You can go ahead and turn there to Hebrews and chapter 11. As this is our third sermon in the five-week series, Faith Is. Faith Is. The half-brother of Jesus, James, in his letter of the New Testament, wrote this in James chapter 2 and verse 17. He said, "So also faith by itself, if it does not have works, is dead." Faith is a working thing, or it is non-existent. Faith is either living, or it is either dead. Faith in God is the way that we move, the way that we live, and in that we find our being. Or either, if not, we're just going by sight as the rest of the world. So we must ask ourselves today, do we live by faith or only by sight? Because faith is this. Faith is acting upon God's word and God's promises, or it's no faith at all. Faith and action are of the same vehicle that carry us through the journey of life. True faith, changes the way that we think. It changes the way that we speak and the way that we act. And if it does not, then we are not living by faith. You would not go to the dealership, the car dealership, knowing that you need a vehicle to take you to places you need to go in life, and you would not purchase that vehicle and sign the papers for that vehicle and then leave the car on the dealership's lot, would you? No, we wouldn't do that. Now, theoretically, you could say, yes, I have a vehicle, but you would never get anywhere you needed to go with it. The vehicle is of no benefit to you in that situation. And so faith with no action is no benefit, if it is even true faith at all. Faith accomplishes things. It performs and completes tasks in our life. And too often, many people say that they believe in God, but they really do not believe or trust in the God they say they believe in. And we've all been guilty of that to some degree or another. I know I have. In those that do not act upon their faith, God is found untrustworthy to these people. They rarely act upon what they say they believe. They say they know a God, a Savior, but they do not listen for His voice through the reading of His Word, through prayer, through meditation, and acting upon His commands. This is not the case of what we come to today in Hebrews chapter 11. This chapter is filled with people that acted upon the will, the words, and the wisdom of God. And you know what? We're still being blessed by the faith of these people that we're reading about. And this is a unique chapter in that it does celebrate and show forth the faith of these people. Most of us are here today because of some degree of faith that's being exercised. You believe to some degree, and so you are here today. Now, but all of us are here today because of someone else's faith. And may we not forget that. You might be a young person here and you've been brought by mom and dad or grandparents. You're here because of their faith. I'm not saying there's not faith for you. I'm just saying we all sit here today because of someone else's faith. We're in this church today because of other people's faith, really, as well as our own. There have been much faith exercised to bring us to this point in history today, in the world and even in this church, and we must continue to walk by faith in the God that created us and saved us through His Son, Jesus Christ. That being said, let's turn now to Hebrews chapter 11, and I'm going to begin reading in verse 7, and we will read through verse 22 of this same chapter. The Word of the Lord says, "By faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear, constructed or built an ark for the saving of his household. By this he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness that comes by faith. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance, and he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith, he went to live in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, living in tents with Isaac and Jacob, heirs with him of the same promise. For he was looking forward to the city that has foundations, whose designer and builder is God. By faith, Sarah herself received power to conceive, even when she was past the age, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Therefore, from one man, and him as good as dead, were born descendants as many as the stars of heaven and as many as the innumerable grains of sand by the seashore. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised, but having seen them and greeted them from afar off, and having acknowledged that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For people who speak thus make it clear that they are seeking a homeland. If they had been thinking of that land from which they had gone out, they would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared for them a city. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises was in the act of offering up his only son, of whom it was said, 'Through Isaac shall your offspring be named.' He considered that God was able even to raise him from the dead, from which, figuratively speaking, he did receive him back. By faith, Isaac invoked future blessings on Jacob and Esau. By faith, Jacob, when dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph, bowing in worship over the head of his staff. By faith, Joseph, at the end of his life, made mention of the exodus of the Israelites and gave directions concerning his bones." All of these stories we find in the book of Genesis. May God be giving glory for his word today. Let's pray. Father, increase our faith today. Help us to see your word and your promises and to trust you with every aspect of our being and to love you, Lord, with all of our heart, mind, and soul and strength as you've commanded. God, as I speak to your people, I pray, Lord, that they will hear your voice and that you will use me as an instrument. Lord, that you might weaken any strengths I think I have and strengthen any weaknesses that I know I have. And God, that I might decrease and that you might increase in this house today. We give you the glory. We ask these things believing in the name of Jesus Christ. And all of his saints said, amen. It is here that the ancient giants of faith are assembled, and we gather to inquire of their faith in God here in chapter 11. Here, in short, men and women stepped forward toward goals that they could not even clearly see themselves. And that's important to understand. These that we've read today and many others like them reached toward ideas that went beyond the understanding of human beings and what man can even imagine apart from a mighty God. Here in this chapter, we see men and women like you and I that responded with faith as God revealed Himself unto them. They heard, and by faith they acted upon God's word and promises. May God grant us the grace to have a living faith this morning. Through these verses, we see what faith is in part. And I just want you to notice the action of faith in the lives of these people. What is faith? Faith is building something in life that brings safety to you and to others based on the instructions of God. We read about that in verse 7 of the life of Noah. By faith, Noah, being warned by God concerning events as yet unseen, in reverent fear, constructed an ark. Noah took the time, the resources, the energy, the patience, as it took around 120 years to complete the ark. It takes all of these resources, all of our time and energy, to build something that matters. Beloved, most of the world is trying to build something. The important thing is what we're building going to last after we're gone? Is what we're constructing, is it not only for the saving of our souls and our lives from danger and corruption, but is it also going to rescue those below us in the generations, your family? This is the first place to always build, is in the home, with our wives, with our husbands, with moms and dads, grandparents, with our children. This is the first place to build something of great value. Constructing a home built by the instructions and command of God, entering into the ark of safety, Jesus Christ Himself. Yes, faith is building. It's built, being a part of building the local church as well. Playing our part, giving of our time and resources and energy and patience to consistently, day after day, week after week, be a part of something that lasts longer than we do on this earth. Faith is building, but also faith is leaving. And we also read about the story of Abraham in verse 8. By faith, Abraham obeyed when he was called to go out to a place that he was to receive as an inheritance. He left his home. He left what was familiar. He left what was comfortable. He left what was known to trust the word of the Lord, that there was a land that God wanted to give him that would affect even today. We know it as the nation of Israel, but even though spiritually it goes for all children of God. So faith is leaving the known. It's leaving the comfortable. It's leaving the familiar and going to places unknown simply because you were listening to God's voice. As the girls were practicing before the service, Leah said, "We're really stepping out of our comfort zone today." That was an act of faith. And God bless you for it. What we saw Jada doing was an act of faith, of stepping out in obedience unto the Lord. We've read stories for centuries or of centuries ago of missionaries and God called to go to foreign lands, but you know, He might be calling some of you to be a missionary or a minister of some type, but it also means sometimes going across the street to our neighbor and speaking to them about the Lord, getting to know them and showing them the love of Christ. Faith is building, it is leaving the comfortable and the known, but it is also living a life based upon the promises of God, even when your surroundings show otherwise. Abraham was called to another land that God had promised him. But you know what? It wasn't like when he got there, everybody else just cleared out of the land. they were still living there. People that didn't serve Abraham's God. He lived by faith in the promises of God, even when our surroundings show otherwise. And this is an act of faith. Even when the circumstances in our life are showing that we're defeated, that we're done with, that we're down, faith believes and it lives actively a life of trust and belief in God. Faith is not only building and leaving and living, but it's also looking. And the word spoke to us today about how they were looking forward to a greater city whose designer and builder is God. And so are we not doing the same? Yes, we live in this world. Yes, we're citizens of this nation, of this state, of this city. But still, to a child of God, our main citizenship is first and foremost in heaven. And we're looking to a city whose builder and designer is God and not man. But even in that, we are looking forward to greater things in times of depression and suffering and grief and loss. It is with faith that we look beyond and believe that God will bring us through and there are better days ahead. No matter how bad we suffer in this life as Christians, believer, this is the worst hell you'll ever know, is the suffering in this life. And to those that reject Jesus throughout this life, this is the only heaven you'll know. There are many, millions upon millions that don't believe, maybe some sitting here today, that you need, as the old timer said, religion. But you don't believe that you need a relationship with Jesus Christ, that you can get through life without it. And that faith is just for weak people. Beloved, first of all, I admit I'm weak. That's why I need the Lord. I don't deny that. Secondly, you can afford to live without Christ, but you can't afford to die without Him. Faith is building, leaving, living, looking. It's also receiving God's power by belief in God's promises, even when it is impossible to us. And we read about Sarah and Abraham conceiving and bringing forth the promised son Isaac, even when they were well, well past the years of bearing children, bringing them into this land. But they believed, and that promise took around over 20 years to come into completion. But they believed, and they continued to walk by faith, and she received God's power. Too often, and I've been guilty of it in my life, we want everything, we want God's power, and then we'll step out. But we're missing the point of faith. We step out, and then we receive God's power. We receive His strength to live the life that He's called us to. Faith is not only receiving, but it's also being obedient. It's being obedient to God's will, even if we never see the promises fulfilled during our earthly existence. And you know, that was the case here. And the Holy Spirit, through the writer of Hebrews, tells us that. These all died in faith, not having received the things promised. Abraham never really saw what would become of the land that God had given them. But he died in faith. And he knew that it would come to pass, even if it was not in his lifetime upon this earth, but in the lifetime of the generations to follow. And it did, and it is, and it will, even for those who know Christ today. And faith is being obedient, even when we never see the promises fulfilled during our earthly existence. We believe that God will work through our faith, even if it's after we're gone, and maybe in the lives of our children or our grandchildren or the young people at church or young ones we've not even met yet or haven't even been born yet, our faith can bless them. It's being obedient. Faith is also letting go. We read the peculiar and yet powerful story, or just a glimpse of it, that we find in Genesis of God testing Abraham and telling him to offer up his only son, the son that finally came, the son of promise, offering him up as a sacrifice. And of course, many of us know that God is not asking us to lay our children upon the altar and slay them today, right? That was a singular case for a specific reason that was foreshadowing God the Father giving His Holy Son as the sacrifice for our sins. But faith is also letting go. As Abraham had to believe, okay, He gave me this son. If He wants me to slay him on the altar, I believe God will raise him from the dead. I think for many of us at times, isn't that one of the hardest acts of faith, of letting go of even things that God has blessed us with? And that sometimes we become too dependent upon the blessing instead of the blesser? Letting go of people sometimes and things that we were given by the Lord with belief that He will reward us with something greater. That's faith. Believing like Job, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away, but blessed be the name of the Lord. Yes, faith is letting go, but faith is also speaking, as we read about Jacob speaking blessings and God's words and even God's warnings to future generations. Faith changes the way that we speak as well. Do we speak blessings to the generations coming behind us? Words of encouragement, words of truth, words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. And also warnings to the generations behind us, the warnings that if they choose not God and faith in Him, there's great suffering and calamity that comes upon them. This is faith as well. Faith is speaking. Faith is also worshiping. For those of you that have truly worshiped today with reverence and awe before your family and friends, you are worshiping. It is an act of faith that you are just choosing to show that God is worthy of your time, that God is worthy of your effort, God is worthy of your voice, God is worthy of your giving. Worshiping is an act of faith. We see that Jacob did that, even bowing over the head of his staff. We do so until we breathe our last, as God gives us strength and grace to do so. We consistently, week after week, gather to assemble, to worship. It is an act of faith. Faith is also preparing. We saw where Joseph spoke of an exodus that would happen of the Israelite people, of his own people that would leave Egypt one day after 400 years of slavery, and they would be led into the land of promise. And he left instructions for after they leave, you bring my bones back to the land that God had given our forefathers. Faith is also preparing for the future, even before you die, for the final promises to take place. Faith is now. Faith is acting now in this day and time. And faith is also setting, and it begins here, your desires upon the promised Messiah. You see, all of these people's faith was based upon the promise that God would send a deliverer that would rescue them. They were looking forward to Jesus. We are looking backward, and we are also looking forward to the second coming of our Lord. Faith is setting your desires upon the promised Messiah because you believe that all of God's promises are going to be completely fulfilled in the person of Jesus Christ. You see, faith is acting. And that's the point I bring out today. Faith is acting upon God's word and promises, or it is no faith at all. Again, look at all the actions here. The building, leaving, living, looking, receiving, being obedient, letting go, speaking, worshiping, preparing, and setting. Faith is being sure of the promises of God, as we read in Hebrews chapter 11 and 1, being convinced of His power to bring them to pass. We also looked last week that faith is believing of God's divine design for your life and for my life and all of the universe. But faith is also acting upon God's words with obedience, even when the world thinks we're foolish, and most of the world thinks you are fools today, and that's okay. Remember, they thought Noah was a fool for those 120 years until it started to rain and the deep waters of the earth began to break up. Faith is living with trust and loving God enough to read His words and to simply say something like this: you know, with the Lord's help, I'm going to live by His word. That's faith. Now, I think it's important to make mention here of what faith isn't. In the lives of these people, especially as we reflect upon them, but also our lives today. Let me make this clear. Faith isn't understanding everything that's going on in life or going on in your life. That's not faith. If you did understand it all, we wouldn't need faith. And that's why some people don't live by faith, because they think they've got it all figured out. Maybe some of you today, you think you've got life figured out. Bless your heart. Because the older I get, the dumber I get. Faith is not having all the knowledge to all the mysteries of life. And I would warn any young people of those older people that think they do have hold all the mysteries of life in their hand. They don't. They don't. And that's not what faith is. To the person that thinks they've got the answer for everything, young people, run from them. They're filled with pride and arrogance and ignorance. Faith isn't having it all together all the time either. Lord knows I haven't. And I never will until the Lord calls me home. That's not what faith is either. And again, steer from those people that act like they've got it together all the time. They don't. Faith isn't being perfect in this life, because none of these people that we read about today were perfect either. And if we were perfected, we wouldn't need faith in a Savior, right? If you read their stories closely, they sinned, they failed, they missed it. These were not without sin. They were not without failure. They were not without fault, and neither are we. And faith doesn't mean that you never fall. As a matter of fact, it means that you fall 7 times, but you just get up 8 with your eyes locked upon God. And by the number 7, it means you fall completely. I'm not talking about a little trip. I'm not talking about a little stumble in our step. I'm talking about a complete face-first flop fall. I've missed it. I have failed in life. But I look up to the God of all knowledge and power and forgiveness and grace and wisdom. That's faith. That's faith. Faith doesn't mean we ever have it all together, that we're ever perfect. It just means that we look to the one that does have all understanding, that does have all knowledge, that does all have all power, and is perfect, Jesus Christ. That's what faith is. We see in these brief accounts the stories of others that have impacted our lives today, but even in your life, there have been those placed within your life, people of faith. And their faith story has impacted your life. You saw them live by faith, not perfection, but you saw them live by faith, and their story got deposited into your lives, and you're better for it. We've heard, watched the faith stories of maybe a godly mother that continued to pray for you and encourage you and teach you about the Lord and His will for your life. Maybe it was a father doing the same. Maybe it was grandparents that you watched their faith life, their faith story being played out before you. Maybe it was other family members and uncle or aunt or cousins. Maybe it was just friends, church, or friends at work, and you watched them live a life of faith, and it got down here in your heart and has blessed you. You know, I'm here today because a young couple with a small girl felt the call of God to leave their home and come to Waco back in 1971. I could see where I'm standing here before you because of that decision. As I said in the first service, some pastors are always looking for a better salary sometimes, or some pastors are, but they came for less. They felt the call of God to come to a place that desired them to come and minister. But you know what? However, at some point of all these people that their stories have blessed our lives, whoever it may be in your life or those people or even the lives of these that we read about in Hebrews 11 today, that can only take us so far. And eventually, we have to start our faith story. Mom and Dad's faith can't save you. Grandma's faith can't save you. The Sunday school teacher's faith can't save you. At some point, you have to start acting with faith in your life. No matter about Mom and Dad's story and how beautiful that has, it still impacts my life each day. At some point, I had to start acting with faith in my own life. And start my own story of faith. And yes, it's connected, but I had to continue the chapters. And that's what many of you Christians are still doing today from what we read. You're connected to these people through faith. And you're still writing the faith story until Christ comes. Matter of fact, you're here today either because of your faith or somebody's faith. Again, you might be here because Mom and Dad brought you and you see Mom and Dad's faith. But eventually, you cannot live by that forever. You cannot get to heaven on somebody else's faith. You have to, by faith, trust Jesus Christ. And maybe today your first step might be coming out and coming to this altar and giving your life to the Lord. And then following through with baptism to show that faith. That's where it begins. That's where the faith story begins, is Jesus Christ. At some point, we have to begin our own story of faith. We can't always live by the faith of others. Where are you today in your story of faith? What do you need to do today, whether young or old, to act upon the promises and the power of the Lord? And I just want to remind you how the next chapter of your faith story will read is dependent upon the faith that you exercise today. It's dependent upon that. Let me ask you one deeper for you church members there and myself. How will this church's story read for the next generation? And by the way, I just want to remind you of a simple fact. it was happening before, and even through this pandemic, churches are closing their doors every month across America in this nation. Don't think that if we don't exercise faith today, that tomorrow ours won't be shutting the doors. Don't think that. Don't take it for granted. Don't take it for granted. We must show faith today. And faith changes the way that we think, the way that we act, the way that we talk, the way that we give, the way that we serve. Do you have a faith story at all? And if not, what's keeping you from your faith story today? And I just want to say, don't let anything, any lie, any thought stop you from putting the pen to paper and beginning to write your story of faith today that will bring forth your salvation, but also maybe start the building of something great that your faith also will lead others to Christ and they will be saved. Don't let anything stop you from that today. And the scriptures today teach us that those of you that will live by faith, God is not ashamed to be called your God. Isn't that a glorious scripture? And not only that, but in this chapter, we read the promise that to those of you that believe that He not only exists, but you diligently seek Him, the promise is that you will be greatly rewarded in this life and in the one to come. With God's grace, may your faith story impact those in your circle of influence, leading others to know Jesus Christ and to enjoy Him forever. Let's pray. Father, may your Spirit be at work among us. May you draw your people of faith into your glory and your promises and your word. And help us, Lord, today to live with obedience and to act with faith and trust in you. Lord, I pray for you today to move upon the hearts of those who need to start their faith story and to receive you as their Savior and to begin their journey of faith in this life. Lord, for the Christian who is maybe a little battered and beaten and has been trod upon a little too hard, would you encourage them? Would you give them the strength to lift up their eyes unto you, O Lord, where their help comes from? May we as Christians also never become complacent, but may we keep living by faith as well. May it impact not only our lives, but our families, our city, our state, our nation, and our world. May others be drawn to your throne of grace and be blessed throughout eternity. God, give us strength to answer the call of any call you're sending out today. Lord, maybe it's the ministry in some way, shape, form, or fashion, to the mission field in some way, Lord. Help us to be faithful and to trust you and to be obedient. And we ask these things in the name of Jesus Christ. And all of his children said together. We're going to sing a hymn of invitation. You know, there's never a time when God's word goes forth that we are not called to respond. Doesn't matter if you're a youth or way, way beyond. When God's word is proclaimed, we are called to respond in some way. I pray that you'll respond with faith today. For some of you, you need to step out and come. You're old enough and you've heard the gospel enough and it's time to start your faith story. God will give you the strength, but you're going to have to step first, and then he gives you the strength. The first step is faith. And so I encourage you to come today. This altar will be open. If you just need to come and pray, I'll be down front to help guide you in any decision that you might have for the Lord today, or just to pray with you. But may we all be obedient to the call of God as we stand together and we sing our hymn number, Brother Brandon.
Jesus is tenderly calling thee home, calling today, why from thy sunshine of love wilt thou roam, farther and farther away, calling
and amen. Thank you all so much. It's been a great day of worship. Amen. Oh, thank you. Be praying for our church. Be praying for your nation. Be preparing your heart to live by faith in the days and years to come. All of us. May God be glorified in and through our lives. I love you so much. Again, we encourage you to be involved in Sunday school next week. And we've got a class for each one of you. So we're excited that we got to start back in that for now. And, of course, be praying for both services at our 9 and 11. And I'll tell you, too, in the weeks to come, I'm going to start preaching again like I was before pandemic and going through the series that you're going to be studying in your Sunday school lesson. Maybe you're watching the online Sunday school, so that's good, too. Or getting involved in class or online and following along, because I'm going to start back preaching along with those like I was before. And Jason, if you will, give the Lord thanks for this day and ask His blessings upon us as we leave.
Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this day you've given us, Father. We thank you for the blessing of seeing another one of your children, Father, moving forward with baptism, Father. We thank you for Jada, and we ask you to be with her and just lead, guide, and direct her in all ways, Father. Father, just be with us. Help us to take this message, apply it to our hearts, Father, just to learn what faith is, to know what faith is, and what's expected of us, Father. And we thank you for that message. Be with us as we travel. Lead us in the directions you'd have us to lead. Let us, your will be in our lives, Father. And may we seek you in all the things we do. Father, forgive us the many ways we fail you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.